Good morning, everybody. We are ready to worship this morning on a beautiful, cool day. I love these days. Cool start to the morning, but fresh day. So let us stand and worship God as we think about our dreams and visions. Thank you. God in heaven, you surprised and amazed your disciples at Pentecost with the gift of the Holy Spirit. We praise you for the Spirit who still fills our lives and hearts. Send your mighty Spirit on us as we worship. Fill us with your joy and excitement. Amen.
Good morning and welcome to worship this morning, whether you're worshiping with us here in the chapel or worshiping at home this morning on Sunday morning or perhaps watching again later in the week. We note with sadness the passing of Eric Szlosky, a longtime member of the congregation. His funeral will be here on this coming Wednesday, 26th of May at 10 a.m. And please keep his wife, Kath, and Eric's friends and family in your prayers during the coming week. For those people who are involved with our care ministry, or for those people who'd like to be involved with that care ministry, there's a meeting today at 10 a.m. And before that, we'll have some morning tea available. So please join us for morning tea before you race down to that meeting if you're involved, or if you're just staying here, have a cuppa and have a chat. And if there's one or two extra people who are available to help with morning tea, that would be useful. You can see the red banners. See, the pastor has a red shirt, although only a T-shirt, so you can tell he's still got that South Australian thick blood. As it gets colder this time of year, you can tell who are the native Queenslanders who put more and more jumpers on. Anyway, welcome to worship this morning, and I'll pass across to Pastor Lee.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to worship here this morning. Yep, I'm switched on. You can hear me. That's good. Welcome to those gathering online with us as well. It's great to be worshiping and celebrating today, being Pentecost, hence the red shirt. And Pentecost is all about a celebration. It's a party. Who doesn't like a party? I mean, we love gathering together. We love celebrating. We love finding good things to be together and celebrate with. And this is like the church's birthday. So we celebrate today the gift of the Holy Spirit coming to us. And so I just want you to take a moment in this time just to reflect. Why do you think God sent the Holy Spirit? Now, I would like for those of you who were here last week or watched online last week to think back maybe to what Rachel was saying last week. It might give you some hints. And if you've got no idea, listen to Jeremy later on. Jeremy Lee is one of our youth leaders. He's well known to our community here gathered. But for those of you who are online, you may not know him. He is fantastic. As a part of his studies, he needs to do he's doing a preaching course. He needs to do an upfront message that is recorded for his studies. And so we as a community are giving him that opportunity this morning to share some of his wisdom and what he's learned and how he's growing. And so if you really enjoy what Jeremy says, please speak to him afterwards and encourage him in his work and in his ministry as well. Our theme for today is what's mine is yours. Maybe you've thought about that as a kid. As a parent, what I observed is that whenever someone had something, and we had toddlers in the house, this was a very true statement. What's yours is mine. But it doesn't go the other way around. You don't share. And probably, let's be honest, we were all a little bit like that when we were toddlers, because that's how we learn and how we grow. But now, as we are more mature adults and those growing towards maturity as well, we learned that sharing is a good thing. Jeremy will unpack this theme for us later on. I have completely forgotten what's next, Elmar. Can you show me? Isn't that a good way to start the morning? I have confessed the number of times that morning is not my time, that I'm really only awake from about 10. I just gave you plenty of evidence. Let's begin today celebrating the gift of the Holy Spirit in God's name. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. As people of God who are shaped and called and gathered and enlightened by the Holy Spirit, let's speak our faith, putting our trust in the Spirit to lead us into all of God's goodness. And so we speak together from the screen. We believe in the Holy Spirit who establishes the Holy Christian Church. We are the church, the people who believe the good news about Jesus, who are baptized and who share in the Lord's Supper. Through these means of grace, the Spirit renews us so that we may serve God in love. All those who live in union with Christ, whether on earth or with God in heaven, are saints. Our communion with Christ makes us members of one another. By his death, Christ removed our separation from God. So by his Spirit, Christ removes all that divides us from each other, breaking down every wall of hostility. The Spirit makes us, who are many, one body in Christ. By the Holy Spirit, we are joined to Christ through faith and adopted as children, the sons and daughters of God. Through Christ, we are raised from death to new life. For Christ, we shall live to all eternity. We now hear God speaking to us through the Holy Spirit as we hear our readings this morning.
The New Testament reading is written in Acts chapter 2, verses 1 to 8 and 12 to 21. On the day of Pentecost, all the believers were meeting together in one place. Suddenly, there was a sound from heaven like the roaring of a mighty windstorm, and it filled the house where they were sitting. Then, what looked like flames or tongues of fire appeared and settled on each of them. And everyone present was filled with the Holy Spirit and began speaking in other languages as the Holy Spirit gave them this ability. At that time, there were devout Jews from every nation living in Jerusalem. When they heard the loud noise, everyone came running, and they were bewildered to hear their own languages being spoken by the believers. They were completely amazed. "How can this be?" they exclaimed. "These people are all from Galilee, and yet we hear them speaking in our own native languages." They stood there amazed and perplexed. "What can this mean?" they asked each other. But others in the crowd ridiculed them, saying, "They're just drunk, that's all." Then Peter stepped forward with the 11 other apostles and shouted to the crowd, "Listen carefully. All of you fellow Jews and residents of Jerusalem, make no mistake about this. These people are not drunk, as some of you are assuming. 9 o'clock in the morning is much too early for that. No, what you see was predicted long ago by the prophet Joel. In the last days, God says, I will pour out my spirit upon all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see visions, and your old men will dream dreams. In those days, I will pour out my spirit even on my servants, men and women alike, and they will prophesy. And I will cause wonders in the heavens above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and clouds of smoke. The sun will become dark and the moon will turn red before that great and glorious day of the Lord arrives. But everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Our response: the Holy Spirit reveals God's words to us. Open our ears to hear the truth. Jesus teaches us about the work of the Holy Spirit in John chapter 15, verses 26 and 27, chapter 16, 4b to 15. Please stand as we hear Jesus' words for us. Jesus said, "But I will send you the Advocate, the Spirit of Truth. He will come to you from the heaven, from the Father, and will testify all about me. And you must also testify about me because you have been with me from the beginning of my ministry. But now I am going away to the one who sent me, and not one of you is asking where I am going. Instead, you grieve because of what I've told you. But in fact, it is best for you that I go away, because if I don't, the Advocate won't come. If I do go away, then I will send him to you. And when he comes, he will convict the world of its sin and of God's righteousness and of the coming judgment. The world's sin is that it refuses to believe in me. Righteousness is available because I go to the Father. And you will see me no more. Judgment will come because the ruler of this world has already been judged. There is so much more I want to tell you, but you can't bear it now. When the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into all truth. He will not speak on his own, but he will tell you what he has heard. He will tell you about the future. He will bring me glory by telling you whatever he receives from me. All that belongs to the Father is mine. This is why I said, the Spirit will tell you whatever he receives from me. Our response, the Holy Spirit reveals God's words to us. Open our ears to hear the truth. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for coming to lead us into truth. Open our eyes and our ears to your creative work in and through us. Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you, choir, for leading us with that. And I'd like to invite the children who are here to come forward. I just need someone who's brave to come first. Yeah, excellent. Come down the front. There we go. Excellent. Oh, still a few more. Cool. Yep, gonna come find a seat. Yeah, you gotta make sure Dad comes, hey, Ryan?
Yeah, I made it.
Excellent. How are you all doing this morning? Are you good? Yep. Is school going well for those of you who are at school? Yes, don't sound too confident. How about, have we got any kindy kids here? Yeah, how's kindy going? Is it good? Excellent. Does anyone have anything that's been really good in this last week that they want to share with me? Anything? Yeah, what? You went for footy at school? Excellent. And did you have fun? Sweet. Yeah. School camp. Excellent. Where'd you go? Excellent. So you headed south and you had fun? No sleep. Yeah, that's normal for a school camp. You've got to just get used to that. Yep. Seventy-8-0 was the score at your rugby match. It was pretty close then. That's an absolute flogging. Well done. What about you? What was your best thing? It's your mum's birthday today. Should we say happy birthday to her? We can say happy birthday to mum, can't we? Hope she has a really good day. And you're going? Yep. You're all going out. Excellent. To celebrate. So it's not just the church's birthday today, it's mum's birthday as well. Excellent. I thought I saw, yep, up the back.
I'm learning about space at school.
Learning about space at school and you're learning how big it is? I think space is pretty cool. So once you've learned some fun facts, come and talk to me. I'd love to hear what you learn, okay? All right, today's a special day at the church. Pentecost, excellent. I was going to ask, do you remember? Yes, you do. It's Pentecost. Pentecost is all about who? Yes, very specifically, there's a part of God. Now, if you were here last week and you remember when Rachel said someone called HS, yes, the Holy Spirit. Oh, good. That's good. I'm glad you remember the Holy Spirit. Now, the Holy Spirit, if you listen to that first Bible reading that Anne read before, the Holy Spirit came like fire and something else. Do you remember? Yes. Speak in different languages. Excellent. That's exactly right. And there was something else that the disciples heard and everybody heard. Yeah?
Strong wind.
Now, we're not talking about smelly kinds of wind here, okay? You know what I mean when I say that, don't you? Not that kind of wind. We're talking about the kind of wind that rushes, that's outside and really windy. And I've got a balloon here. What do we usually put in a balloon? Excellent. Is air like wind?
Yeah.
How?
It can move,
exactly. What's wind made of?
Air.
Excellent, we got there. So, apples, you reckon?
Atoms.
Sorry. I wasn't expecting a very scientific answer for that one. And I was wondering how apples fit into it, but no, atoms makes a lot more sense. I'm putting some wind. Do you think I'm going to burst it?
Yes.
Hands up if you think it'll burst. See, all of the adults trust me. although my daughter just said she doesn't trust me. Excellent. So we've got some wind in here, haven't we? Is it doing anything? Is it rushing? No. It's all contained, isn't it? I'm just holding it. That's right. But the Holy Spirit came and there was a rushing wind. There was a rushing sound that gathered the people together. That was pretty lame, wasn't it? It's... The Holy Spirit came with rushing wind. And it drew people to come to see what was going on. There was a noise. And everybody heard it. And they went, what in the world is that? And that's when the disciples started talking in other languages. And the people realized that something was going on. Something that was really special was going on. But it was that wind that drew the people there. Let it go. Well, it's not going to go very far. It's small. Do you want me to let it go? I've got to blow it up, okay? And if I blow it up, it means I've got to stop talking. Should I Elsa it? We'll find out later. The people came to hear the noise and see what was going on. And that's when Peter said something really important. Peter said, this is all about Jesus. Jesus, yeah, I wouldn't blow in that if I were you. It's not COVID safe. It's all about Jesus. Jesus came and he died and he rose again and he came so that we could be a part of God's family. And so God used this funny wind, not the smelly kind, the wind kind, the air kind, to draw more people. And at the end of that story, we didn't hear it read, but there was a whole heap of baptisms. Have you ever heard that? Does anyone know how many people got baptized on that day?
100.
More than 100.
1,000.
More than 1,000. More than 2,000. Up the back. 3,000 people. Can you imagine 3,000 people getting baptized? You know, if this wasn't COVID times, we could probably fit about 1,000 people in here if we had the back doors open. So three times that many people. Is that a lot? Can you imagine how long that church service would have been? No. Good thing they probably had more than one people. 100 days, maybe. More than one person doing the baptisms. And so that's why we're celebrating today, because of that wind, the Holy Spirit, and more people coming to know Jesus. You know what? You can help tell other people about Jesus because you have the Holy Spirit living inside you. Let's pray. Holy Spirit, thank you that you live inside us. Thank you that you give us God's power. Fill us with your power so that we can share the good news about Jesus. Amen. You can head back to your seats. No, you're going to stay here? Okay, well, you can lead the singing for the next song. We're going to sing.
Holy Spirit. I am evidently a Queensland local. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Jeremy. I went to Redeemer here. I've been around a little bit. I have a fair bit to do with the evening service and the youth group here. And they thought, hey, you wear ripped jeans. You're really enthusiastic. You can do Pentecost Sunday. So that's why I'm here today. Firstly, I'm going to step us through Pentecost in terms of why it mattered back then, why it matters today, and also why it matters tomorrow. Because I don't think a message is really complete if it slaps on Sunday but then doesn't matter on Monday. So firstly, why it mattered back then, and to give us an image, I want to talk about my dog. That's not actually my dog. I didn't have a picture of me and my dog, but that's Ralph. That's my friend's dog, if anybody knows the Ropelins. But my dog is fairly similar to that. My dog's name is Molly. Hands up those of us who have a dog in here. Yep, okay, fair few. So my dog, I shouldn't say my dog, because it's really my mum's dog. And she loves my mum. Whenever my mum goes on holiday, anyone have a dog that just sits there at the front door and stares longingly into the distance, waiting for its owner to come back? Anybody have that kind of dog? Yeah, that's Molly. And Molly just sits there, whether it's 10 minutes or 10 days, it doesn't matter. When mum comes back, Molly just gets so excited. And I think that can actually give us some insight into why the day of Pentecost mattered to the Jews back then. Romans 8 says that creation groans in expectation, that we, along with creation, groan in expectation. And that's what it was like for these Jews. They had been promised over the last hundreds, thousands of years that there was a coming Messiah, that there was a coming Christ, and actually that this Jesus was the Christ. Sorry to make you follow me around, Carl. That this Jesus was the Messiah. And they'd spent a few years following him around and going, yes, watching him, witnessing miracles and going, yes, this is the Messiah. We have groaned in expectation. We have waited for this day. It was like Molly when my mum comes home. They were like, yes, he's here. But then he says some things that make them wonder. And has anyone ever expected something so much? My fiance Caitlin and I, we've just moved into a house yesterday, and we've been looking for so long, and then finally this house came along. It was like the perfect house, and the amount of satisfaction of fulfillment that we got finding the right house that had the backyard, the dishwasher, praise God. Sorry, Holy Spirit. The amount of fulfillment we got from that expectation of wanting that home, of wanting something so badly. Can we imagine if we hadn't have got this home? Like, we would have been fine, but let's scale that up. Because the way that Romans 8 talks about this groaning and expectation, it talks about labor pains. It talks about waiting for a baby to come. It talks about birth. What if there's complications in that birth? What if actually something goes wrong and the baby doesn't come? That's what it was like to hear Jesus speak these words. I've got to go away. I'm leaving you. And they're like, no, you just came. You're going to overthrow the Romans. You're going to bring God's kingdom. You're going to restore Jerusalem. He says, no, I've got to go. But I'm not leaving you alone. It's actually better if I go. Because if I go, I can send you the Holy Spirit, the Advocate. And that is so much better. Now let's talk about why it's so much better. So for us today, what can we gain from the Spirit? There are so many things that I could have talked about today. There are so many things in the text. And I think, actually, we could do a whole series on the Spirit. We could do a whole series on the Spirit and still not have enough to say about it. But today I want to talk from this topic, what's mine is yours. Because Jesus in John, he says, all that the Father has is mine. And we actually get a glimpse into the relationship Jesus has with the Spirit here and with the Father as well. It's like this dance. It's like this giving and taking. We heard that last week. And he says, all that Father has is mine. The Holy Spirit will take what is mine, what has been given to me by the Father, and make it known to you. And I think there's actually this gospel truth going on of Jesus saying, what's mine is yours. In the coming of the Holy Spirit, I'm actually making accessible to you what has been accessible to me through the Father. And I think underlying this sentiment is what is true of Jesus, or what was true of Jesus back then, is now true of you. And I think that carries forward to us today. Anybody know the first time the Spirit shows up in Scripture? Genesis 1 all points to Neil. So, all throughout the Bible, there are these like hyperlinks, right? When you go on Wikipedia and like you click on that thing that's underlined and it's in blue text, that's called a hyperlink, and it takes you to another web page. All throughout the Bible are these hyperlinks. And so when Jesus says, I think it was in our John passage, he says, I've not told you these things because I was with you from the beginning. Now, whenever you hear that word, those words, the beginning, in the mind of the Jews, that sends them straight back to creation. And that's actually John's whole thing. So in John 1, we hear that the Word was God. In the beginning, the Word was God. The Word was with God. The Word referring to Jesus. And so in the beginning, there's this theme throughout John. And so John 1 takes us to Genesis 1. And the imagery of the Spirit in Genesis 1 is like a bird hovering over creation. The word for hovering in the Hebrew is only used two other times to refer to the way a bird hovers. Now, I wonder, thinking hyperlink, is there any other place in Scripture to do with Jesus that we've seen a bird hovering over the waters? It's in Matthew 3. It's in a lot of accounts, actually, but it's Jesus' baptism. And the imagery we get is that the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of God, the Spirit of truth, comes down from heaven and hovers over Jesus in the form of a dove. It says in bodily form like a dove. And in Matthew's version, it actually says, and alights on him. And we get the flame imagery. Now, in Jesus' baptism, and there's so much to this, but in Jesus' baptism, we receive what is given to him in that baptism. What does the Father give him in that baptism? The Father gives him a new identity. Maybe it wasn't new. Maybe it was already there. Maybe it was already there, but Jesus was awakened to it. He says, this is my child. I love my child. My child gives me joy. I take delight in my child. And so when Jesus says what's mine is yours, that's actually true for us. I notice the timing of Jesus' baptism in the stories is before he ever does any of his ministry. Before he embarks on his journey of ministry for 3 years, he is baptized, he is grounded in his identity as a child of God, dearly loved, and God takes delight in us before we've ever done or said anything. That is who we are. And that is what the Spirit gives us. But it doesn't finish there, because that imagery carries us back to Acts 2, where the Spirit lands on the disciples' heads like tongues of fire. And Jesus finally says, what's mine is yours. The kingdom of God has been inaugurated. The kingdom of God is here, and the Spirit of God lives in you. And why it matters for us today is because I think some of us are still living in the old identity. Some of us are still trying to live out of this works righteousness of we have to be and do certain things in order to be worthy of love, in order to be this person that we want to be. But we actually, in the Spirit, have a new identity. We actually aren't anchored in this world. We aren't anchored in things like career and success and money. We're actually anchored in God. We're anchored in the Spirit. So reflect for a bit, like, are you living life in the Spirit? When you think about who you are, when you think about your identity, is that anchored in what happened on the cross 2021 years ago? Or is it anchored in what happened 3 days ago and you just can't let it go? Is it anchored in what happened 3 years ago and you just can't let it go? Where's your identity? Are you living life in the Spirit? Now let's move on to why it matters tomorrow. In John, Jesus gives us this instruction. He said, you are also to testify. Like the Spirit testifies of my life, you are also to testify. Because it's not enough just to know who we are and whose we are. We're actually sent on mission in the world. So it's not just Jesus' identity that is given to us, it's actually his mission, the things that he started, the things that he began to do. He says, I'm handing it over. I'm with you. But I'm inviting you to participate. Because the life we live isn't stagnant, isn't static, it's a dynamic life in the Spirit. The Spirit brings life and activity to us. And so to get a better understanding of this, I want to anchor it in Scripture. Sorry if you can't see that. I try and make the text really big all the time because I'm so blind. But this is Matthew 28. This is Jesus' last commission, sort of, to his disciples. He says, therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age. So this word go there, in the Greek, it actually means as you go. Carl and I talk about that often. The word go, make disciples, it means as you go, on the road, as you go about your life, make disciples. And I wonder what would happen if we change that word nations, make disciples of all nations. What if we change it to workplaces? What if we change it to daycares? What if we change it to sport clubs? What if we change it to schools? I think we can get complacent in postmodern life. I think we can be like, oh yeah, the gospel's already gone out to like all these countries and there's so many translations and so many languages. Like, we can just live a good life. And that's awesome. We do get to live a good life. We do get to live a blessed life. However, there's so much more to it. So therefore, go, as you live your life, where do you live your life? Do you live it in workplaces? Do you live it in homes? Do you live it in daycares? Do you live it in sporting clubs? Where is your life at? Because that's where the Spirit shows up. Where did the Spirit show up in Acts 2? He didn't show up in the temple, in the synagogue. He showed up in a house. Acts 2 says, the Spirit filled the house where they were sitting. So I wonder what it would look like if the Spirit filled your house too. But we know that the Spirit doesn't actually fill physical spaces. It fills our hearts. It fills us. So we don't need a house. We don't need a synagogue. We don't need a temple because the Spirit lives in us. And as we go, we are empowered to make disciples, to testify about what Christ has done in our lives. Let's pray. Holy Spirit, come, make yourself known to us. Remind us of the things that Christ has done for us, in us, and through us. In a world where it's so easy to take the route of distraction, the route of complacency, Lord, empower us to testify about you in our lives, in our workplaces, in our houses. We thank you for the gift of the Holy Spirit, Jesus. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we pray. Amen. Hand it back over to Lee.
Thanks, Jeremy. Giving and acknowledging that God has so richly blessed us. He's given all that is his and has made it ours. Let's respond in thanks and praise. We'd usually give our offerings as we sung this next song, But we'll collect that during Holy Communion, as has been our practice. If you want to start giving electronically, you can see details up on the screen. If you can't grab that quite that quickly as it's up on the screen, or you don't have a pen with you, it is in the bulletin as well, so you can find those details there. But let's respond to God's gifts, the many gifts that he gives to us through the Spirit as we pray together. Life-giving Spirit, bring to the bones of these gifts the flesh of our actions and the breath of our caring, that our church and our service to others may come to life in your name. Amen. Let's stand and sing Consuming Fire. You may be seated. The Spirit of the Lord fills the world and knows our every word and deed. Let us then open ourselves to the Lord and confess our sins in penitence and faith. We pray together. Holy Spirit, you are so full of energy that you are like fire. Like fire, you came upon the disciples at Pentecost. But our lives past week have not blazed with your Spirit. Forgive us, we pray, and fill us with your Spirit. Come down, O Spirit. Fill us and set us on fire. Amen. There is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, because through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit is of life sets us free from the law of sin and death. And if the Spirit of God, who raised Jesus from the dead, lives in us, God, who raised Christ from the dead, will also give life to our mortal bodies through the Spirit who lives in us. Through Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. And through the Holy Spirit, we are transformed. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we are set free. Amen. Having been forgiven by God, we come before him to receive his every blessing given to us in Holy Communion. The Lord is here. Praise the Lord, for the Lord is good. Sing praise to his name. My mouth will speak in praise of the Lord. Let every creature praise his holy name forever. We pray together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And having given thanks, he broke it, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take and eat. This is my body, broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." The same way, he took the cup after the supper. And having given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink of it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, shed for you for the forgiveness of your sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me."
So let me just confirm our communion procedures for this morning. First of all, I'd invite our helpers to come forward now to help prepare communion and to get that ready. And while they're doing that, you might like to pass the peace with those around you with a nod or a wave or a smile or all of those things. So this morning, as per the last few weeks, we'll have three communion stations. So two right here at the front and one up here in front of the altar. The stewards will direct you to come forward row by row through the side aisles, and they'll direct some of you perhaps to come forward to the front communion station. You'll receive bread in a small bag and individual cups of wine. And so as soon as you receive those, you can take the bread out of the packet. All the wine is wine without alcohol. Gluten-free wafers are available on request, so please ask the deacons if you'd prefer those. There's small bins in the centre aisle here where you can put your used cups and bags. For communion here at Our Saviour, all are welcome, so we invite all who believe that they receive the body and blood of Christ in this meal to join us for communion. Our children's ministries will be continuing, so children can exit via the rear doors immediately after they've been through up to communion for either communion or for a blessing. And finally, a reminder that we'll collect physical offerings at these times. Many of you give electronically, but those who'd like to give physical offerings, the stewards will have offering bags, and you can just drop those in. And the invitation. In those days I will pour out my spirit, and everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. All is ready. All are welcome.
Thank you.
the body of our Lord Jesus Christ and his holy and precious blood strengthen and preserve you in body and soul to life eternal. Go in his peace. Amen. Let's spend some time speaking with our loving God in prayer. Let's pray.
Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, on this Pentecost, we give you thanks for the gift of the Holy Spirit. You gave us Christ to be a brother who continues to walk beside us, a friend who would love us without condition. Father, you gave us the Christ who was our Redeemer, regardless of our sin and our inability to forgive ourselves. So at Pentecost, we receive the gift of Christ in us, and regardless of our sloppy imperfections, help the world see Christ in us. In our error, may his light shine. In our pride, may his love win through. In our baptisms, may our faith for you continue to grow.
At this time of continuing uncertainty, your Spirit is our certainty, the light and guide through our darkened but beautiful world. Give us eyes to hear the cries and ears that listen deeply to the needs of others. May we, in service to your word, serve all your people without prejudice, in kindness and generosity, just as you have been continuously and eternally generous to us.
Guide our church locally in her mission for expressing truth and drawing people toward God. May your church find ways to be more effectively outward-looking as it guides the eyes of society into the needs of all people. Bless the church throughout Australia, especially as state and general synod preparations continue. Bless our local, state and federal government as they find new ways to work together. Give all of our leaders bipartisan tenacity in their creativity and resilience in the problem solving required for good government.
Bless us in our callings on this earth in whatever you have called us to do. Plant deeply in us your seed of truth, and may the mark of eternal love be the signs of peace in the world that others see. May we step boldly with confidence in the world you gave us authority to manage. Continue to arm us with the words of Scripture that can cut through the ubiquitous deceptions of the devil.
Bless all who suffer loss in our community. Assure them of your love through us and through your word. Bless the children and families as they grow their faith in the faith in the cocoon of the home, and grant us all new eyes to see, like children do, the truth that your word reveals.
God, you yourself here are present, here by your Spirit. Hear our prayers and go with us into the new week. In your eternal love we pray. Amen.
We've been filled with the Holy Spirit as we've gathered here in worship today, and God will continue to fill us with God's Spirit as we go about our week. And so receive God's blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace. Amen. Let's stand and sing, Shine, Jesus, Shine.